divided the wears into two categories, mainly the gravity wears and non-gravity wears. So their function as gravity wear or as non-gravity wear was quite evident from their name also. Like gravity wear resists most of the forces acting on it due to its own weight. It is heavy enough to resist almost all the forces which are acting on it. So out of all the forces, the main force that is prominent and it is to be resisted by the self weight of the wear or the overall hydraulic structure, that is the uplift pressure. So we'll be discussing uplift pressure in subsequent lectures, but the major force that is to be resisted by the self weight is uplift pressure. And if a wear is able to resist the uplift pressure by its own weight only, then that wear is called gravity wear. And if it is not capable of resisting all the uplift force due to its weight, we need to install the concrete floors with reinforcement so that the cantilever action of the floor slab resists the uplift pressure. Okay, so in that case, that wear will not be termed as a gravity wear, rather it will be a non-gravity wear. Apart from that, based on the design criteria or material, we divided them into further three categories, like vertical drop wear, then sloping glacis wear, and rock fill or masonry wear. Okay, so those details you can see in the class notes. But thereafter, now the next topic will be the components of a wear. Wear is not simply a wall. We cannot provide a wall only on the bed of a river. Rather, it has to be secured by some other components also. So what are the basic components of a wear that we'll be discussing in this lecture? And what are the causes of failure of a wear? If a wear which is provided on the river, if it fails, what are the modes that can cause the failure of a wear? And what are the basic elements of its design? So elements of design basically are the guidelines which are to be kept in mind while designing the wear. In this particular lecture only, we will discuss the procedure of designing a vertical wall wear also. Okay, so we'll be discussing components, causes of failure, the elements of design, and in the elements of design, after that, we will be considering one design procedure also. Okay, so I have sent you a message in the WhatsApp group that you should be ready with a notebook, a pen, and a calculator also. Calculator is required for a very short span of time only. But mainly, I need you to keep your notebooks and pen ready, because during this lecture, you will keep noting some key points that you find that they are worth noting down. Because something I will be speaking up, it is not there in the presentation itself, because that will be the explanation only. So you please keep your notes also with you while the class is going on. You keep writing some key points regarding the lecture. Okay, so that later on when this presentation will be shared with you, so you can recall the entire lecture. Okay, let us move further. So this is the diagram of a wear section, the entire wear section, and this is shared with you in the class notes also. This diagram is available in the books also, though I have regenerated it on the computer, but similar diagrams are available in the books also. So what are its various components? So it is very clearly written over here that this particular trapezoidal section is the wear wall. So this is the cross section of the wear wall. So wear wall is running perpendicular to the screen. Okay, and on top of the wear wall, we have provided crest shutter. So this is the crest shutter, and you can see that wear wall is of more height than the crest shutter. That means most of the storage that is obtained in the upstream side, that is due to wear wall. And some storage can be increased further by installing the crest shutter. So these crest shutters can be removed also. So when you install these crest shutters, then the storage can be increased up to this level. So including the crest shutter, whatever is the maximum level of water that we can store on the upstream side of this VA section, that is called the pond level. Okay, so all of you know that weir wall is provided to stop the river water and to create a temporary storage on the upstream side and to raise the water level so that this water can be transferred or diverted into an off-taking canal. So from river to canal, the first level of diversion that is carried out with the help of diversion headworks, and in the diversion headworks, this weir is an important structure. Okay, so this weir wall's function is clear, and this is the crest shutter. Its function is also clear. We have to increase the storage to some extent. So we can design this entire structure for the pond level that is shown over here. Out of that, the total storage, some part is stored by the weir wall and some part is stored by the crest shutter. So crest shutters are the option to increase the water level up maximum up to this pond level, which is the design pond level. This function of both of these two is clear. So, but this weir wall cannot rest on the loose granular bed of the river. It has to be rested on a solid platform. So this is this gray shaded portion. This is a concrete floor. Okay. It is concrete floor, but it is impervious to the water also. So that's why its more prominent name, or the more you can say the familiar name, is impervious floor. We don't call it as concrete floor only. We prefer to call it as impervious floor because its impermeability has the important role. So it does not allow the water to move to the subsoil in this portion. Though the entire river bed is pervious, so the water in the rivers keeps on seeping down from everywhere, infiltrating down. So, but in this particular portion, we have to prevent the infiltration of the water into the soil below. So that's why we need to provide the impervious floor. Of course, this impermeability is obtained by providing concrete. So this concrete floor provides us the impermeability, and that's why it is called impermeable or impervious floor. Along with this floor, if you see, we have these two lines, and what we have written over here is it is upstream sheet pile and it is downstream sheet pile. So obviously this is the impervious floor. On the left hand side, we have the pondage, we have the storage. So this is the upstream side of the weir and this is the downstream side of the weir. So in this impervious floor, on the upstream end of the impervious floor, we have installed this upstream sheet pile. And here also we have installed a sheet pile because it is on the downstream side. So it is called the downstream sheet pile. What you are seeing is just a line over here, but it is mentioned that it is a sheet. So why it is a sheet? Because this sheet is running perpendicular to the screen. Okay. So what is its basic function? In the next slide, it will be more clear that how it is provided below this impervious floor. Basically, its function will be more clear in the next chapter, where we'll be discussing about the seepage theories. These sheet piles actually reduce the uplift force on this floor. These sheet piles reduce the uplift force on these floors. So what is uplift force exactly? That will also be discussed there only. But for the time being, let us understand that the water that seeps from the bed on the upstream side, that not only goes vertically downward as percolation. In the previous semester, we have discussed the difference between infiltration, percolation and seepage. So here, when the water from the storage goes into the soil, that is called infiltration. Thereafter, it moves under gravity vertically downward, that is called percolation. But what you see is on the left hand side of this weir wall, we have this much depth of water from this floor level to the pond level, so this much depth of water is available. But on the right hand side, as of now, there is no water. But if more water will be coming after that, this pond level, the water level will cross this pond level, design pond level, and it is go above that, and some overflow from above this weir wall and shutter that will be observed. In that case, you will have the flow in the downstream direction also. But definitely there is a difference between water levels on upstream as well as on the downstream side of this weir wall. Okay, so in this particular situation, when there is no overflow, so water is stored up to the top of this crest shutter and it is maintained up to this pond level, and there is no water on the downstream side. So larger the water depth, more will be the pressure exerted on the bed of this floor, on this block protection launching apron, and here the river bed also. So more pressure will be exerted on the river bed. So that pressure will inject the water into the pore structure of the soil. So that is, that pressure will be initiating the infiltration. And that infiltrated water will not only go vertically downward under gravity, but it will have the tendency to move from underside of the structure and come out to the downstream side of the floor. Why? Because there is difference in the water levels on both the sides. So there is difference in the pressure heads. So while entering, entering into the pore structure, that means after the infiltration, the infiltrated water will have the tendency to move from this high pressure area to this low pressure area, that is zero pressure over here. So high pressure to low pressure, the movement of water inside the soil's pore structure, that is called seepage. Okay, so that seeping water, here the pressure is very high, and at the downstream end the pressure is zero, and in between everywhere the pressure will be reducing from a high value to a zero value. So in between it will be a non-zero value. In between, the water will be at a pressure which is non-zero, but it will be less than the initial pressure, but it will definitely be more than zero. So whatever pressure is there at any point, so that pressure is exerted equally in all the direction. So in the vertical direction, it will try to lift this structure upward. That's why it is called uplift pressure. Okay, so this much explanation of uplift pressure is sufficient as of now. So that uplift pressure tries to lift this floor up. So this floor has to resist the uplift pressure by its own weight if it is a gravity weir, or we have to install, we have to provide the reinforcement also here, so that the uplift pressure can be resisted by the cantilever action of this beam, of this floor slab. Okay, so these sheet piles increase the passage of the seeping water, increase the length of the passage of the seeping water, thereby reducing the uplift pressure that acts on this floor. So these upstream and downstream sheet piles, on one hand, they reduce the uplift pressure, but there is another function also. When the river bed on upstream as well as on the downstream side goes down because of this covering action of water during floods, so going down of the riverbed may cause hanging up of these structures in the air, in the middle of the air, so they cannot hang on in the air, so they will be definitely settling down. Okay, so this is a flexible portion, so settling of this portion will not endanger the weir wall itself, but this portion is a rigid one. If this if the soil is removed from the underside, let us assume there is no sheet pile as of now. Okay, if sheet pile is not provided, then the bed level will go down in this area, and it will remove the sediment or the soil from underside of this bed also. So this much portion of the floor will be hanging in the air and it will be cracking down. It will be trying to deflect down, so cracks may appear on the floor. So any crack on the hydraulic structure, that means failure of the hydraulic structure. So we need to prevent this type of failure. So scouring, the damage due to scouring is also prevented by installing these sheet piles. Okay, so sheet piles, they have dual function: to reduce the uplift pressure on the floor, on this floor, and to reduce the damage due to scouring. Okay, so all these components are clear as of now. Remaining components are: on the upstream side, we have block protection and launching apron. On the downstream side, we have an arrangement similar to that of block protection, but it is called inverted filter, and followed by the launching apron again. Okay, so these block protection and the inverted filters, they are apparently same, with the difference that here you are seeing no gap between these blocks and the bottom layer. Here you are seeing some gaps between them. It is the only difference. But in general, when we are going to provide it, we are going to provide it this bottom layer in the form of a gravel bed, and on the top of it, closely spaced concrete blocks. That means with no gap while stacking them, no gap is left in between them, but they are not joined with the mortar. They are loosely placed only. So these are the blocks which are placed just adjacent to each other. But on the downstream side, the similar blocks are placed with some gap in between. And here also, it is not the gravel bed only. It is the material in which the grading of the material is provided in the form of an inverted filter. So in a sand filter, if you want to filter the water and you want to create a sand filter, so what you do? In the bottom layers, you provide larger particles, or you can say the pebbles or the bajri type material. Thereafter, you provide the material of reducing size. So on the top of it, you provide the coarse sand, and top of the all, you provide the fine sand. So when the water is poured into that filter, it will first enter the fine sand, it will move down to the coarse sand, then further to the larger particles or aggregates. So likewise, when the water moves from top to bottom in that filter, the pore structure, the pores of the material, they become wider and wider. So the permeability keeps on increasing. So water, once entered into the filter material, finds it more easy and easy as it goes down, easy to flow as it goes down. But here, in this particular structure, this portion is in the inverted form. That means as you move from bottom to top, the size of the particles keeps increasing. So the permeability increases from the bottom part of this layer to the top part of it. And in these gaps, we fill the bajri, or you can say the aggregate. Okay, the coarse aggregates are put into these gaps so that these gaps are maintained also, and the water can come out easily from this portion. And why this inverted filter is provided? I told you that seeping water will try to ooze out from this downstream end, and we provide this safe passage for that water to come out. We don't want that this water should come out from here. We provide this passage here also, immediately on the downstream side of the floor, so that water can easily come out from this portion and move to the downstream side. And now we are left with this launching apron. So how this launching apron functions, let us move on to the next slide that will make it more clear about this structure also, because we are going to see the same structure, the entire structure of the components of wear in three dimensions diagram. So this is the three dimensional visualization of this structure. So what that previous this concrete floor or the impervious floor looks like is this. So this is the three-dimensional visualization of the concrete floor or the impervious floor. So on the riverbed, first of all, we provide this type of a floor. Okay, so this floor is designed before actually providing it in the field. So the thickness, which is shown at various points in the varying thickness, that means in the middle it is more thicker, and on the downstream side of it, you see that the thickness is reducing. Further downstream, it is reducing further. And at the end and in the upstream side, we have the least thicknesses. So why and how these thicknesses are provided, they will be calculating again in this seepage theories in the sequent lectures, but this floor is designed and it is provided on the riverbed. Above this concrete floor, we provide this weir wall. Okay, and on top of this weir wall, we provide the crest shelter. So this is the 3D visualization of how the structure would look like. Okay, so these are the sheet piles. Sheet piles are running. In the previous slide, you have seen in the form of lines only, and I told you that these sheet piles are running in perpendicular to the screen. So now it is very clear that why they are called as sheet piles, because they are in the form of sheet, and they are called piles because they are driven very deep into the riverbed. So they are not a single ordinary piles only, they are piles in the form of a sheet. So that's why it is called a sheet pile. So on the upstream side of the this impervious floor, this sheet pile, it is called upstream sheet pile, and which is provided on the downstream end of this concrete floor or the impervious floor, that is called the downstream sheet pile. So simple naming is there. Now on both of the sides, what you see is on the upstream side block protection, and on the downstream side inverted filter. So till now we have discussed the functions of every component till now. So we are left with this launching aprons. Okay, so launching apron on both of the sides, we have to discuss how it functions. So this is the pond level. Okay, up to top of this crest shutter, what you see is water is heading up to the top of this crest. Okay, so when water is heading up to this pond level, so there is no water flowing to the downstream side. Or we can assume that very little water is coming from the upstream side, which is there at present in the river. And because the water is only heading up to this top of the pond level, we are diverting this water to the off-taking channels also. So we are not allowing any water to go to the downstream side. Okay. In that particular case, these launching aprons, they stay intact. So these two launching aprons, so now you are seeing in the red rectangular enclosure. So these launching aprons, they stay intact as we have provided. Okay, but what happens when flood comes, when more water is coming from the upstream side and it is much more than what is diverted into the canals? If you divert the water into the canals, so some part of the flood water will be diverted, but the flood water is much more than the diversion capacity of the canals. So most of the water will be going to the downstream side. So how that water will be going to the downstream side, and what will happen to this pond level? So now the water will not be maintained at this pond level, rather it will be overflowing over this structure, over this weir, over this crest shutter. And now this pond level has gone because water is not up to the pond level, and now the water level is called high flood level because it is the water level due to flood. And highest flood level, or HFL, is when we get the highest level of the discharge in the river for which we have designed this structure. Okay, so let us assume that highest flood discharge has come. In that case, whatever will be the level of water on the upstream side, that will be called HFL on the upstream side. Similarly, this HFL on the downstream side will also be maintained during this high flood. So when the flood will be there, so this water level will also be maintained, will be at its maximum level. So it will be called downstream HFL, or the highest flood level. So in this particular circumstance, when the water is coming on, lot of water is coming from the upstream side and lot of water is going to the downstream side also, in that case, this water will have its covering action on the riverbed. And what happens to this launching apron? Because that riverbed will be going down. If on the both of the sides, if the riverbed is going down, that will endanger this structure also. So how this launching apron is going to protect us? See carefully these launching apron, what happens to it. So as the riverbed goes down, these launching aprons, they, because they are loose stones only, so they launch themselves in this slopy fashion. And now they are not called the launching apron, rather they are known as launched apron, because they have launched themselves in the desired position. So this is a stone pitching, you can say the stone layer here, which protects the structure, which protects this particular soil in this area to get scoured out because of the scouring action of the flowing water. So this slopy portion of the stone, it provides protection to this entire structure. So the structure, the structure is not damaged. It protects the structure. When the flood wave passes and the normal flow conditions prevail again, so this will not come back. It will be there, but it will keep protecting. Now, when the normal conditions will prevail, this water level, this bed level may start building up again because of the deposition of the sediment that comes from the upstream side. But this launched apron will remain in the position of the launched apron only, and it will keep protecting. Because the river bed is loose, unconsolidated, and cohesionless material, so these loose stones can go further deeper also, and the exact layer may not be maintained in future also. So we keep on adding more and more stones over here, so that in case of the floods, the launching apron keeps its function on, and it keeps protecting the entire structure. So here we have one text line also, that after the river scours out the bed, the launching apron launches itself to provide a protective armor layer at the slope of 2 horizontal to 1 vertical, and is called launched apron. Okay, so the slope of this particular launched apron is 2 horizontal to 1 vertical. That means whatever is the depth of depth up to which the riverbed has covered out, so twice that depth, this horizontal length will be there. So it will be sloping in the with this slope 2 horizontal to 1 vertical. So we have to design this launched apron or the launching apron so that in eventuality of the flood, it will launch itself into this loop. Okay, I think up to this point, it is very clear to you. So here, let us discuss something more about the launching apron. So the scour protection provided for some components of hydraulic structure in the form of stack of loosely packed stones. So it is a stack of loosely packed stones. So here the stones are not joined together in the form of stone masonry. They are not joined with the mortar. They are loosely placed stones only. Okay. So it provides a scour protection to some components of the hydraulic structure. Here it is providing the safety to this sheet piles and this floor only. But actually, when we provide the scour safety to some component, ultimately it is meant that the entire structure is secured. So that safety is extended to the entire structure. So it provides the protection to the entire structure. So it provides, it is provided in the form of stack of loosely packed stone on upstream and downstream end of the structure. So we have discussed it that on both of the sides, we have provided these launching aprons. If you zoom in this portion and see it in the bigger view, so this is the view of the downstream protection. Similar will be the case with the upstream protection. So how to provide, how to design this launching apron? See, this is the portion. It is the launching apron as laid. This is how we provide the launching apron. Okay, we provide the launching apron in this fashion. Some thickness is provided and some length is provided, and perpendicular to the screen, it will have the length equal to the total width of the channel. Okay, so that we'll be discussing later on. If the water is flowing above this, up to the HFL, so what will happen? The water because above this floor, the water is up to this HFL. Now I have removed this shading. The depth of the water which is flowing above this launching apron up to this HFL, that is, let us say it is Y. Okay, so depth of flow is capital Y over here. So LACES regime's cover depth, if you calculate that how deep this riverbed can go, so for that Lacy has suggested this cover equation 1.35 Q square by F raised to power 1/3. Okay, and it is measured from the HFL. So this R is the regime's cover depth below this HFL. That means this R value is measured from this HFL in the downward direction. So if the let us say the river bed will be coming up to this level, from this level to this HFL, this entire will be R. Okay, so this, with this equation, you can calculate the regime's cover depth. Here small q is the discharge intensity. Discharge intensity, I'll be explaining it later also, but as you know, in the fluid mechanics also, discharge intensity means the discharge passing through a 1 meter width of the channel, not the entire width. From the entire width, the total discharge capital Q passes, but from 1 meter width of the channel, how much discharge passes, that is small q. Okay, and this F is silt factor, and it is determined, or it is calculated by this formula 1.76 under the root D50, and D50 is the median particle size of the riverbed material. Okay, so 50% of the particle are finer than this size, and 50% of the particles are coarser than this size. So that particular size is called D50. So if that size is determined with the help of sieve analysis, then square root of that D50 size multiplied by 1.76, that will give you the value of silt factor F, and that F is to be used over here. So we will work out the value of R. So this is the value which is suggested by Lacy, but we have to multiply this value of R by some safety factor. So that safety factor X ranges from 1.25 to 2. Okay, so 1.25 to 2. So how this factor varies from 1.25 to 2, it is recommended for different situations, different value of X is recommended. So in the sequence slides, we'll be discussing that also. So X times R is the total cover depth below HFL. So if you subtract this Y, okay, so that will be maximum possible cover depth below floor level, because this R or X times R, that is measured below this HFL. From this, how much deep will be the riverbed? Okay, from this floor level, if you want to calculate, you have to subtract this Y from this. So XR minus Y is the depth of scour below the floor. So from the floor level, how deep you have to go, that is capital D. Okay, so how this Y is determined? HFL minus floor level. So it is very simple. High flood level, if this level is given to you, floor level is given to you, so difference of these two levels will give you the flow depth. So this is D now. So this D we have provided over here, that what bed level will go this much deeper. Okay, up to this level. So this is the probable deepest scour level in the eventuality of the flood, when the design flood will come, according to Lacy's regime theory. So it will have the tendency to move up to this level. So this bed level will go at the most up to this level, not beyond that. Okay, under no circumstances the bed level of the river will go below this. Okay, so this is the probable deepest scour level. Okay, if deepest scour level is there, then this depth D is same as here. And if you see a point over here which is at a 2D distance from this initial level of this launching apron, because it has to launch itself at a slope of 2 horizontal to 1 vertical. So twice D here and 1D over here. So this will be the slope like this. Okay, so this launching apron, because this launching apron is launching apron as laid, this is what we provide. But in case of discovering, in the case of flood, it will launch itself into this position. So this is the launched apron. So launched apron will be of this shape. And if you see this top line, it is up to this deepest scour level. And this horizontal dimension is twice D. And this vertical dimension is D. So in this particular triangle, we will be doing some calculation. So this launching apron is supposed to maintain its thickness 1 meter. So that is also in the guidelines, that at least 1 meter thick launched apron should be there. Mm-hmm. And if this is 1 meter, so we'll be using this 1 meter in the calculation of the quantity of stone. So, but if you see this triangle, height is D, base is 2D, then this dimension, how long it will be? Can you calculate it? Okay, you have to calculate this value. Okay, if you have calculated it, I have launched a pole. Answer it fast. How much will be the value of that question mark that I have shown? Hurry up, please. Just 10 more seconds, not more than that. Hurry up, please. Okay, I'm ending the poll. I'm sharing the result that you have given to me. See, 9 students are saying that it should be 5D. 7 are saying it should be 1.25D. 4 are saying it should be 6.25D. And 5 students are saying it should be 2.25D. So I'm getting the answers from all the options. That means somewhere the calculation is not done quickly and correctly. Okay. So let us see what is the value. Its value is 2.25D. Its value is 2.25D. Because it is a right angled triangle, simply apply the Pythagoras theorem, square of this dimension plus square of this dimension, that is equal to square of this dimension. So d square plus square of 2d, that is 4d square. So 4d square plus d square, that becomes 5d square. So 5d square is basically square of this side. So if you square root, take the square root of 5d square, it becomes under root 5.
Hello?
And under root 5d is the value equal to 2.23. Okay, so this value is 2.25d. Any doubt on this?
No, sir.
If you have any doubt, then you can just write only. Right here only. Okay, it's clear to all of you. That's nice. So let us move further.
No, sir.
Right.
No, sir.
Now, see here, if the volume of stone per unit width of the channel is to be calculated, that how much volume of stone we have to put over here. The same volume of stone will be there in this launched apron. Okay? So we are calculating volume of stone per unit width of the channel. So unit width of the channel is basically perpendicular to the screen. So in the perpendicular direction, you assume the depth of this particular launching apron into the screen, that is the width of channel, that is 1 meter. So perpendicular to the screen, you take the dimension as 1 meter and try to calculate the volume of the stone in this portion. So in this launched portion, what you know is that thickness is 1 meter, width is 2.25D, and perpendicular to the screen, the width is 1 meter again. So the total volume of stone will be 2.25D, that is this dimension, multiplied by 1 meter, that is this dimension. It gives you area of this parallelogram. Okay, this gives you area. If you multiply it by 1 meter depth perpendicular to the screen, so it is going to give you the volume. So this is the volume of stone in this launched apron, and this volume should be same as provided. So what value we have provided over here? Okay, what value we have provided over here? Up to a distance of 1.5D. So we provide a launching apron up to a distance 1.5D. So this dimension comes by experience. These instructions or the guidelines the researchers have suggested on the basis of their experience and the experimentation. So we have to provide this up to 1.5D length. So if this is D, we have to provide it up to 1.5D. So we can provide the same volume in a smaller length also, or in the larger length also, but in that case, the launching of this apron will not end up into this desired armor or desired shape. Okay, so 1.5D length launches itself up to a total distance of 2D later on. Okay, so if this length is 1.5D and thickness is T, if this is thickness T, we have to design this thickness T, that how deep this armor bed is to be provided, the launching apron is to be provided, and the perpendicular to screen, it is 1 meter. So this entire thing, if you equate both of this thing, that means volume in this particular layer and volume in this launching apron as laid, so you get the thickness as 1.5 meters. So if you equate these two things, so 1 meter cancels out with 1 meter. So this D cancels out with this D. So what you are left with is T is equal to 2.25 divided by 1.5. It gives you T as 1.5 meters. So, okay. So thickness of 1.5 meters is to be provided. Okay. So this thickness is fixed now. It is 1.5 meters. And length is 1.5 times this D. Okay. And if you provide 1.5 times the D as the length of apron and maintain the thickness as 1.5 meters, it will be ultimately launching itself in the desired shape of 1 meter thick armor layer at a slope of 2 horizontal to 1 vertical. Okay. So this is about the design of the launching apron. You have to calculate the volume of stone. Is it clear? Any doubt till now? If there is no doubt, we can move further now. So the salient points are, launching apron is a loosely packed stone. It is an apron of loosely packed stone. Its function is to protect the impervious floor and sheet piles from the damage due to excessive scouring. Okay, so we are just recalling these functions. Its design depends upon the velocity of flow, because it depends on the scouring action, of course, the scour depth also, and the slope of the launched apron. So we have designed in the previous slide, we have designed it for 2 horizontal to 1 vertical. If you want to design it for some different slope also, again, you can make the calculations accordingly. Size of the stone is determined from the velocity considerations. So larger the velocity, larger will be the size of stone required, because otherwise water will be carrying that stone along with it. If the particle size or the stone size is smaller, then it can wash out those stones. So velocity of approach is equal to 4.915 square root of the D, where D is the mean diameter of the stone, and VA is the velocity of flow in meter per second, and D is the diameter of stone in meters. Okay, so from this consideration, you can calculate, if VA is given to you, approach velocity is known to you, you can calculate the value of D accordingly. Okay, this is one suggestion, this is one guideline that you can calculate on the basis of the velocity. But in actual practice, what happens is stones of 0.4 to 0.5 kilonewton, that is 40 kg to 50 kg weight, they are possible to procure and handle. Okay, so these stones are called one man stone. Okay, so around 40 to 50 kg stone, it is a single stone which can be lifted by one man only. Otherwise, a little smaller stone that will be on the lower weight side, so it will be washed out in the eventuality of the flood. If the stone is larger, because size of the stone will not become large enough, if you see 60 kg of weight or say 70 kg of weight of the stone, that stone will not be large enough to allow two persons to pick it simultaneously, because the size is not very large and there is no space for two persons to hold it. So we prefer 40 to 50 kg of the stone, which is easy to procure and handle by one man only. So it is called one man stone. So in general, in the exams also, or in competitive exams also, you can get this question also: what is the weight of one man stone in kilogram or in kilonewton, whatever it is mentioned. So how much is the weight of one man stone? So that you should be knowing, it is 40 to 50 kgs.